In the vintage PC community, December is DOScember, a month dedicated to videos about Microsoft's disk operating system, better known as MS-DOS, and the various other versions and clones of it, such as IBM's PC-DOS and Digital Research's DR-DOS. There are many DOS-related things I could do videos about, but I wanted to document a little-known version of Microsoft's DOS that never came to be, but which could have changed the history of computing forever. Well, maybe not, but you can't really find any reference to this online, so I thought I'd dig up what I can find about it and share it with you. To begin with, we have to go all the way back to the January 1982 issue of Byte magazine, and keep in mind this would have been written in late 1981 when the IBM PC was just a few months old, and their editorial of that issue was written about the operating systems that were written and being planned for the IBM PC. Here they wrote, IBM has decided to let the marketplace determine which of its three operating systems will become dominant, if any. Thus you can get UCSD Pascal, CPM 86, or the IBM Personal Computer Operating System from Microsoft. But they are excited about Microsoft's approach to the IBM PC, and they mention Microsoft had then recently introduced XEDOS, its superset of UNIX, which today has formed the basis of both Linux and macOS. But back in late 1981, when this was written, XEDOS was at the top of a pyramid of upward compatible operating systems to be made available by Microsoft. At the bottom is the IBM DOS, called MS-DOS by Microsoft. In the middle will be XEDOS, a new operating system written in the C language for the 68000, Z8000, 8086, and LSI-11 processors. XEDOS will contain XEDOS-like features and will be essentially a single-user version of XEDOS. So that was Microsoft's original plan for the IBM PC. You would start out with MS-DOS or IBM DOS, and if your needs grew for larger capacities and capabilities, you would upgrade to XEDOS, and then eventually, if you needed a really powerful computer system, you would step up to XEDOS, which was their version of UNIX. But aside from that one editorial in Byte magazine in January 1982, I can't really find any other information about XEDOS. Although in a discussion on Quora entitled If Bill Gates Had Chosen UNIX as the base on which to develop the Windows operating system, would Windows still be the dominant operating system today? Mark McCartan Lim, computer science professor at Wabash College, said that Microsoft had at some point intended to migrate DOS users over to XEDOS through a single-user variant of XEDOS called XEDOS, which essentially was the idea of Linux long before Linux existed. Ooh, I don't think Linus Torvalds and Richard Stallman are going to be happy about that, saying that Microsoft came up with the idea of Linux before they did. So you may think XEDOS is just a long-lost idea of Microsoft that never got off the ground and never got released and has pretty much been forgotten today. But actually, it did get released. They just didn't call it XEDOS. Instead, they called it MS-DOS 2.0. In this article in the November 1983 issue of Byte magazine, the headline was MS-DOS 2.0, an enhanced 16-bit operating system. Features such as installable device drivers and XEDOS compatibility have improved this popular operating system. And they said it represents a significant advance in personal computer operating systems. And here's an ad which explains it a lot more succinctly. It says, the UNIX connection. XEDOS is the multi-user, multitasking, UNIX-derived operating system for 16-bit microcomputers. MS-DOS 2.0 is Microsoft's single-user OS. MS-DOS and XEDOS share hierarchical file structure and I/O redirection, including simple piping. MS-DOS 2.0 also provides XEDOS-compatible system calls. That means there's a migration path for programs written to run under MS-DOS and XEDOS. What's more, both MS-DOS and XEDOS are supported by Microsoft languages. That's your single supplier advantage from Microsoft. Microsoft may have also decided to abandon the XEDOS name because of potential confusion with Zenith's version of MS-DOS, which in American English is also pronounced XEDOS. So here I am at the MS-DOS 2.11 prompt. This is the Tandy 1000 version, but that doesn't make any difference. And I'll show you some of the Xenix or Unix-like features that would have been in XEDOS, but instead got integrated into DOS 2.0. First and foremost is the introduction of subdirectories with the mkdir, or better known as just md command to make a directory. So I'll make a directory called test. Now I can change that directory. And now we're in the test directory. Interestingly, it printed it in lowercase. And another capability borrowed from Unix and Xenix is piping. For example, I have a basic program I want to display on the screen. But once it gets past the first screenful, it scrolls by too quickly to read. So the way you can pause it after every screenful to let you read it is to type the file and then pipe it into the more command. And you can see now, once it fills up the screen, it shows more at the bottom, and you can press the key and it'll fill up the next screen, and so on and so forth. And the next feature that was borrowed from Unix and which would have been in XEDOS is redirection. So for example, you have this directory listing here and you want to save it into a file. And the way you do that is you type the command and then the greater than symbol and then the file name you want to redirect the output of the command into. So I'll call it dirlist.txt. And that redirects the output of the directory into that text file. So then we can edit it or print it. And you can redirect the other way too with the less than symbol. For example, I created a text file called time.txt and it contains a specific time I typed in of 20 o'clock or 8 p.m. And I can redirect that into the time command. So if you had some crazy idea to always set the time to 8 o'clock p.m., you could redirect the contents of this time.txt file into the time command, and that'll automatically enter a time of 20 o'clock. And that's a pretty stupid example, but it's the only one I could think of off of the top of my head. So that's all pretty rudimentary stuff. Anybody who has learned DOS in the past 35 years is familiar with those concepts. But there were actually some hidden commands in DOS 2.0 that were designed to make it more Xenix-like, to make it more like what would have been XEDOS, but were never documented and were discontinued from DOS 3.0 and later versions. These are two config.sys commands called availdev and switchar. And you can see I just created a config.sys file containing the commands availdev equals false and switchar equals dash or hyphen. So we'll restart MS-DOS and we'll see what difference that makes. So at first everything looks normal, but let's type a command, for example, dir/w. And what happened? It says file not found. That's because with that switchr command, I changed the switch character from the slash to the dash or hyphen, which is what Unix and Xenix uses. So now instead of dir/w, I have to type dir-w. And now it works as intended. And notice something else? Where it says directory of a colon, instead of a backslash, it uses a regular slash. That's because since the slash character is no longer needed for the switch character since I changed it, it's now used for directories just like Unix or Xenix. So for example, I can make a directory called test. And to change into that directory, I type cd/test instead of backslash. And now we're in the test directory. And to go back to the root directory, instead of cd/, you type cd/. And now I changed the prompt into what would be more normal for later versions of DOS. And notice instead of A colon backslash, it says A colon slash. So this is a feature undocumented in MS-DOS 2 intended to make it more Unix-like, which was removed from later versions of MS-DOS because they never documented it. For some reason, they never wanted it to be used, even though they designed it into the product. And this was all part of what would have been XEDOS, but instead got integrated into MS-DOS. And remember that command I added to config.sys called availdev equals false? That changes the way devices are addressed to make it more Unix-like. And you can see on the directory there, there's some file names that normally would not be possible to create, such as null and com1. Normally those are reserved device names, so you normally cannot create files using those names. But since I added this command to config.sys, now the way devices are addressed is more like Unix. So for example, you know the copy con command, which allows you to type text directly into the keyboard and save it into a file from the DOS prompt. But now, with this command in effect, the way the device is addressed is to type /dev/con and then type in your file name. And now we can type whatever we want and it'll save the file. And now I deleted that config.sys file with those availdev and switchr commands in it. And I'll restart, and now things should be back to normal. dir/w should work like normal now, and yes it does, and also notice the directory is backslash instead of slash. And if I try to create a file called lpt1, it's not going to work. It's actually redirecting it to the printer like it's supposed to, instead of creating a file called lpt1. So that's just the quick history of XEDOS, the planned operating system for Microsoft that would have been the stepping stone between MS-DOS and Xenix or Unix, but never came to be because instead its best ideas got integrated into MS-DOS 2.0 and left some odd quirks along the way, which were never officially documented, but which you can use to make MS-DOS work more like Xenix or Unix or what today you would call Linux.
This new generation will enable a whole new set of applications. In fact, there'll be hundreds and hundreds of great applications that take PCs much further than they've gone before and allow us to move towards this exciting vision of a machine on every desktop.